All right, good afternoon. It's good to see everyone. Very excited today, especially after last week's message. I was very, really touched by Daryl and Gina sharing. I think one thing that I take away, Daryl talked about, is always about journey with God in every stage of our life we're going through. A lot of time, we just don't know what's going to happen to us. But what is needed from all of us is to have faith, stay the course, and let God reveal himself to us. And I think that on that alone, I find it terribly exciting. I think some of us has gone through different stages of our life, different encounter, different experience. And I'm sure you can attest to that, right? But I think the important key thing is that always stay on course, because you never know what God is going to do in your life. I think with that, on that note, today we have my brother, Royston, is going to share today. I'm equally excited. I went through his slide. Guys, I tell you, it's mind-boggling. It's really something. His PowerPoint is really power. I don't know who did that, either himself or the wife or the kids. And it put me to shame. The next time I put up PowerPoint, I don't know what to do, man. But anyway, I think he has a very good message to share, and that is something that I truly believe, even as we pray just now, I think God has a specific word for all of us. Today, those of you who are here and those who are downloading through Zoom, I can tell you that you're blessed, because this is indeed God's words, and this is what God wants us to hear. So without much further ado, let us welcome Royston. Come.
Hello, everybody. Good afternoon. My name is Royston. If you don't know by now, I'm your doorman usually. But today, I swap duty. The doorman number two is on duty. So thank you, Malcolm. All right. Anyway, before we start the word sharing, this morning I woke up and I saw on my phone the app, and the verse is really touching my heart, because I knew that today I was sharing, and this word is really so timely. I believe God is trying to encourage me. So I sent it out to my cell group this morning. It's actually from Book of Luke, chapter 12, verse 40. It reads, "You also must be ready, because the Son of Man will come at an hour when you do not expect him." So with that, I will start this afternoon's word sharing. So let's begin with this afternoon session with reading from the scripture, and it's from the Gospel of John, chapter 5, verses 5 to 9. Let me read it to you. "One who was there had been an invalid for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and learned that he had been in this condition for a long time, he asked him, 'Do you want to get well?' 'Sir,' the invalid replied, 'I have no one to help me into the pool when the water is stirred. While I'm trying to get in, someone else goes down ahead of me.' Then Jesus said to him, 'Get up, pick up your mat and walk.' At once the man was cured. He picked up his mat and walked. The day on which this took place was a Sabbath." A very familiar story to many of us, I'm sure. In case you did not catch it, the title to my word sharing this afternoon is "The Power of the Place." There are several words that are appropriate to be used to describe the fruits of God's work: justification, redemption. Sorry, I forget to click the slide. Too many things. Pardon me. Justification, redemption, revival, sanctification, and regeneration. But there is one word that simply summarizes all the fruits of God's work in our life, and that work is better. So remember the word better. Once our God is at work, he never involves himself in an area he does not improve. Whatever he involves himself into, it improves. It may not improve immediately, which many of us know, but it will eventually improve. It may not feel better, look better, seem better, but when God gets done, it will be better. Because he never involved himself without the intention to improve, to make it better. And let me tell you, our God does not work incompletely, but he does works incrementally. So if it's not better, he is not done. Because when he gets done, it gets better. And it's important to understand not just what God does, but also how God does it. In Psalms 103, verse 7, it says that God lets his acts known to Israel, but his ways known to Moses. One thing to know what God does is another to know the way he does it. And our improvement is intimately associated with our environment, and place matters. Catchword. There's a principle affectionately titled the principle of the place. This principle simply suggests that our identity, our purpose, welfare, as well as our well-being is not only impacted by who we are with, but also equally affected by where we are. So place matters, remember. Even in a creation narrative found in the book of Genesis, God took 5 days preparing the place and only one day creating the man. Adam was not created until the sixth day. Lots of words, but I will tell you the story, right? So God spent the first 5 days creating the place as we all lived in right now. This was because God knew if his creation was going to thrive, he has to place him in the right environment. It does not matter how big, powerful, or strong a fish is. If you take a fish out of its environment that God has created it to thrive in, the fish will not survive. God knows which environment he needs to place his creation in for his creation to thrive. God has plans for you to have a better life. Just like it was written in the book of Jeremiah, God wants to prosper you. And we know this verse very well. It is Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11, and it reads, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future." You may think you have the plans for your life, but the scripture tells us that God knows the plan he has. It does not say that we know the plans that he has. You need to know there are chapters in your story that may not have read, and there may be times and seasons in your story where you wanted to put a full stop. But God has other plans. He wants to put a comma at that point because he is not finished. The best is yet to come. God has better for your life. Believe it and give thanks. God wants better, but he knows that improvement is intimately connected to the environment that we are in. And he knew what environment to place us to aid and assist us in experiencing better. So I say again, place matters. But guess what? The enemy knows it too. Okay, the devil, he knows it too. That's why the enemy aggressively attempts to take people out from the environment that they need to be in order to thrive. So notice in the creation narrative what happened to Adam and Eve when they disobeyed. They were booted out from the Garden of Eden. They were no longer in the environment that God has created them to thrive in. And that is in the Old Testament. Now let's take a look at what happens in the New Testament. And it's clearly personified, and Jesus used the parable of the prodigal son to share this example. So we know this story as well, right? In Luke 15. So just look at the younger son. What happened to his life? You know, it started to go downhill the moment he left the place. And the place is his father's home. So place matters. Sorry. And like I said earlier, because our improvement is closely connected to our environment, and God's church serves as an embassy of God's kingdom to create a different environment in the city so that people can have a healthy alternative to the experiences that they were having in a place where, you know, it is not conducive for them to thrive in. The church represents and creates a different kind of culture that is counter to the culture in many cities, which most time are a catalyst for death and destruction. But in John 10:10, Jesus says that he came so that we may have life and have it to the fullest. God's church is a life-giving culture where death comes to life. When people come to church, marriage comes back to life. Dreams comes back to life. Relationship comes back to life. Family comes back to life. Life is given in a church. And in Agora, church goes beyond these walls around us. Just as in Matthew chapter 18, verse 20, that reads, "For where two or three gather in my name, there God will be there with them." Not to mention, as our Lao Da, which is not here today, Daniel reminds us, week in, week out, he says, church starts on a Monday. So church starts when we start. All that has just been said is portrayed powerfully in the story that we read in the beginning, right? In the Gospel of John, chapter 5. A reference to the scripture that was read earlier, Jesus was journeying and he happened to arrive at this place named Bethesda. And Bethesda is made up of two words. Beth means house or place, and Hista means grace or mercy. Therefore, Bethesda means a house or place of grace or mercy. The place people go to get what they don't deserve. Grace is unearned, undeserved favor. That's why our lives are changed. That's why we are saved. Our God is a God of grace. As Apostle Paul reminds us in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8, that is through grace and not works that we are saved, lest any man should boast. Scripture wrote that to get to Bethesda, one needs to go through a ship's gate in order to get to the pool of Bethesda. There is only one gate, there is only one way. As one gets through that one gate, that one way, it gets them access to the pool, and they did not have to access to on the other side of the gate where there is a porch, you know, that is supported by five pillars. And this place is also known as a place of grace. And Bethesda in this story is a metaphor for the church, because Jesus is the way, the gate that us as sheep needs to get through. And as we get through the gate, we gain access to the pool, which in this story is a metaphor for the Spirit of God. And the pool is covered and upheld, by five pillars, which is what Apostle Paul calls in Ephesians chapter 4, the fivefold ministries, consisting of the apostle, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastor, and the teacher. So this place is the church, and the church is the place of grace. The church is the place that people come to get what they don't deserve. And as we continue, it says that Jesus went to this place and there was a multitude of people who had various different issues, just like all of us, right? Remember that the scripture had a natural definition. It is written exactly what it meant, but it also has a spiritual meaning, which is the bridge that takes us from what it means to what it meant to you as a person or me. And in the place of grace, there are all sorts of people, all right? So for example, there are blind people there. And that metaphor for people who are living life with no vision, it is a visionless existence. Life without any sense of direction, without any purpose. And the Bible says that when there is no vision, people cast off restraint. When someone can't see, it is easier for them to get lost. And when people stay lost in life because they can't see. So blind people and lame people were all found at that place near the pool of Bethesda, you know, or earlier I mentioned the place that is called grace. The lame people in the scripture is a metaphor for those of us who is in a season of our life when time is moving, but we are not moving. So take note, these blind and lame people were all over this place of grace, needed to get better, but were not getting better, right? So Jesus walked into this place and walked around all these people till he came up to this particular man who has had this one condition for 38 years. We all know there are problems everywhere in our world, right? The Bible has told us so. However, it is one thing to have a strong problem, but it's another thing to have a long problem. Have you ever experienced a long problem? A stubborn situation nagging at you, something that you feel that is hampering, hindering, and prohibiting you in experiencing the fullness of God's best for a long time. Well, that is when you experience a long problem. So take note that Jesus walked to this particular man, right? We keep saying, or I keep saying, and he asked that lame man, "Do you want to be made better?" So Jesus was asking this man a question of feeling. Because Jesus was about to give this man some instruction, and the instruction was counterculture of that day. Not a circular culture, we all know, but it is about counterculture to the religious culture of that time. It was because Jesus was about to ask this particular man to do something that was considered taboo based on the religious tradition of that time. That's why Jesus asked to make sure that the lame man really, really wanted to be made well. This was because, as we could see from the end of the story, that after this man got well, he ran into some people who will critic the way he was practicing his religion. That's why Jesus asked the lame man, because he wanted him to be sure, as he will be handling the critics, you know, from these religious teachers and religious elders who was around this place, who do not understand why Jesus was telling him about doing things in a different way. So do you want to get well? Because there is some instruction to follow. And all of God's instruction evokes some emotion. God's instruction makes us emotional. And how we handle the feelings that God's instruction invokes determines what are the decisions we make. And the decisions we make determines our condition. It determines our outcome. So another quick story that we are very familiar with, involving a big fish, all right? So obviously I'm talking about Jonah, right? So when God told Jonah to go towards Nineveh, he got really emotional, right? If we remember the story. And when God told him to get into the fish, he also got really emotional. And when God tells us to love our enemy, well, it stirs up a lot of emotions in us as well. You know, emotions like apprehension, trepidation, confusion. And in the scripture, Jesus told the lame man to get up, pick up your things, and walk. Jesus told the lame man to do something that he has not done for 38 years. Imagine you not using one part of your body for 38 years. I cannot imagine. But anyway, because when you are in a place of grace, the place of grace will challenge you to do things that you have not done in decades. Jesus could give this instruction because only the Creator knows the potential of His creation. And just because you have not done it does not mean you cannot do it. Just now, Ivy asked me, every year you IPPT go. Okay, I just leave it as it is. Okay? And sometimes, only when God's word stretches us, we discover the potential that is in us. Potential that we don't even know we possess. God is using the church to introduce you to a you that you may not have met yet. And there is a you on the inside that is stronger, that is wiser, that is gifted, that is anointed, confidence, secured, and God uses the place of grace to stretch you so that you can lead and serve His purpose. And if you did not even know till you got into the place of grace, when you get into your Bethesda. So, do you want to be fixed then? And as we observe in the scripture, when the lame man was asked by Jesus if he wanted to get well, he was quick to say yes. I mean, if I were him, I also want to say yes, right? But at the same time, he pointed out the limitations. The lame man shared that every year, the angel came to stir the water in the pool, and whoever gets in got healed. But someone always gets in before him because he did not have anyone to help him. Therefore, he had to come to the place of grace and watch other people get what he wanted. Watch them get in first into the pool. You know, so what I'm trying to say that for us men, there will always be limitation. We will always be giving reasons why we can't do this and why we can't do that. You know, so although the layman believed this, you know, which is getting into the pool when you will get well, and the people around him believe that too, but there's nothing in the scripture that supported that belief. Only the first, which is, you know, first to enter the water will get healed. Hence, this belief and expectation was clearly rooted in, old religious tradition and not firmly based on the word of God. So there are limitations in the evolution, even though they were in the right place, but they were not practicing the faith in the right way. They were practicing a superstitious, superficial spirituality where it is belief, if I move the right way, all my issues will be fixed. But that's not spirituality, right? That is probably magic. And Jesus was about to improve the layman's situation by giving him instruction. He is empowering him to work a principle that's going to change his condition and his life. It is a powerful picture in the way our faith works. So what do you want to depend on? Faith or faith? You decide. So now, how to be fixed? We do not experience better just by some magical zapping or some rolling in some water, right? All the instruction comes from God's house where the instructions are all principle-oriented intended to get us better. Therefore, if there is praying and fasting to be done, and if it is not carried out, means we are actually ignoring God's or instruction to take up our bed and walk. And Jesus knows that there are things that you do not know that are in you. So Jesus always does the almighty to the most unlikely. God always calls people in their exact area of weakness, insecurity. That's what God did to Moses. You know, God asked him to go speak to the Pharaoh, where we knew that that is his main weakness. He always believed that he was not articulate, but God sends him on that way anyway. And we all know the story, right? Moses not only speak to the Pharaoh once, he went and speak to the Pharaoh many times. So God always stretch us in the areas of our greatest insecurity and weakness. Similarly, Jesus was even stretched on the cross because purpose always, always stretches you. So Jesus told the lame man to get up and walk, but the lame man responded with an excuse. But Jesus ignored it, even though the excuse was true, right? Because the lame man is laying down there, honestly, because he's lame, he can't get up, so clearly he can't get into the pool. But then the excuse must not be the reason. Because if you obey God's instruction, you will find out that you can get strength where once was weak. You can get ability where once fragile. Get power where once was weak. So Jesus did not just tell the lame man to get up. He told him to get up and get the thing that once got him, hold the thing that once held him, and carry the thing that once carried him as testimony to everyone else about what happens when you get into the right place. Brothers and sisters, God wants to empower you to hold something that used to hold you down, something that used to be on top of you, but now you can get on top of that. It used to carry you, now you can carry it. It was your test now, it will be your testimony later. It was your misery, but now it can be your ministry. Because God helps you to carry what used to carry you into the place of grace. So I'm actually coming down for the landing. And we all know from the scripture that we read that that day when that thing happened, it was the Sabbath. It is important to know that no one was supposed to do anything on the Sabbath, right? During those days. So what did Jesus did? Jesus introduces to this lame man a new way of practicing an old religion. Same content, different container, an out-of-the-box approach to an ancient tradition. Jesus wanted to show a new way to do things in the church, not for the purpose of being new, but for the purpose of moving you beyond the limitations of your previous experiences and expression. Thus, Jesus did some out-of-the-box ministry that day. And as that man carried his bed and started running, we all know the story, right? He ran into some religious leader who said, "What are you doing carrying your bed on a Sabbath?" You know, that's what they noticed. And they completely missed the fact that the lame man, this lame man that has laid down there by the pool for the last 38 years, was actually walking. I mean, I'm not sure whether they were operating with sight or not. Huh? They wanted to discredit The miracle because of the method. Okay, and the method was not just different, but it was because it was done on the Sabbath. But look at just how passionate and convicted the lame man responded. He told the religious leader that the one who healed me told me to carry this bed. So I am carrying it because I tried it your way for the last 38 years and I was still broken, still bruised, and my life was falling apart. And then today, I met Jesus and had an out-of-the-box experience and my life became changed. Therefore, brothers and sisters, we need to be connected with an out-of-the-box church, with an out-of-the-box place, because God is going to use you to do out-of-the-box things. And through it, it may not make sense now, but keep watching, keep observing, pay close attention, because God will show you the power of the place of grace. So, and we are Agora. You know, Agora, if you Google, what does Agora means? Agora means a meeting place. So, we are the place. Agora, we are the place. Every single one of us here, you are the place. So may our Lord increase our wisdom and stature and grant us favor with Him and men, so that we can truly be the salt and light at the marketplace. So brothers and sisters, let's go out there and be the place. The place of grace where people can draw towards us and be empowered to have their life changed. Thank you.
Thanks, Royston. I don't know how about you. There's a saying, they say that you can take the boy out of the kampong, but you cannot take the kampong out of the boy. So this guy, even now, he's worked in the Ministry of Health. He speaks like an army officer, right? Be brave, be better, and you still don't listen, he'll fix you. Right? Joke aside, I think what a wonderful message today. I think one of the things that perhaps I just want to add on, Royston mentioned that church start on Monday. But you know, when they say start, which means something has stopped, I want to add further to say that the church is every day. There's no beginning, there's no end. It's that we are living being, a living organism. We are what church is all about. And in fact, if we read through all the scripture, you realize that Christ does most of his wonderful works outside the churches. He preached in the synagogue, yes, there's some miracle was done, but most of his work is outside the church. He ministered to the people. He go to the needy. In fact, even when he was hanged on the cross, he's still ministering. He tell the Peter, forgive them because they don't know what they are doing. Even he was hanged on the cross, he's still doing his work. He's performing miracle. He's using himself as an embodiment of what church is all about. So, wonderful message I think Royston has shared. And it really resonates with me. I think when Danny and I, a few of us, get together to talk about Agora, it's really about this concept of the church without a wall, about a limit. It's all about each and every one of us operating in the marketplace that we do. And Royston talked about a lot. We have a lot of potential within us. We just don't know it. God has put in something very precious within us. We are all anointed. But don't get me wrong, being anointed doesn't mean that you have to be like Daniel, go pounding the pulpit and share the message and tell some funny jokes. No. Being anointed means that you live your life as a living testimony of God. Everything that you do, people can see. God can see. You know the impacts of God in your life.
And as you live your life fulfilling, as you say, you're ambassador of Christ, that everything we do will reflect His glory. Every word that come out of our mouth is a representative of what God says. So guys, be careful. When you watch football match, don't curse, okay? Even your team play terrible, don't curse. Because you represent God in the marketplace, in the place that we talk, we engage people, right? So, beautiful message, and I really enjoy it, and I hope this will stir all of us on. And more to anchor ourselves in what Agora 252 is all about. It's all about challenging ourselves. It's about engaging God on a daily basis. It's about seeing every opportunity to be God's spokesperson. That we look around, the people that need help, people that need encouragement, people need us to go and extend our hand. And even by ourselves, when we're going through difficulty, how do we hang on to God? How do we live through that crisis and come out and share a testimony? I think a few months ago, our brother Wang was here, was sharing about what he had done in the Middle East. That really blew my mind, right? He's talking about speaking in tongue. And then one of the Middle Eastern guys kind of tell him that is the dialect. And that, to me, is truly a representative for what the church is about. He was doing his work. He just gathered a group of people, come together, he prayed on the spot. That is essentially what church is all about. You know why? Because someone else's life was impacted that day. I assume the worker is a pre-believer because he's probably a Muslim coming from a Middle Eastern country, right? But can you imagine the kind of impact on his life when Brother Wang prayed in his mother tongue, in his language that only a few people know? I think deep in his heart, he knows that this God is real. The God that Brother Wang has worshipped and acknowledged is real. And that created impact, and that's what church is all about. So with that, today you got everything on me. I open and close. I also sing song for you. Not bad. Everything. So maybe some, you want to stand out. I think God is really good. This is a beautiful song. I know my sister Jasmine sang it last week, but I think it's worth singing again. That we shall always remember the goodness of God in our life. And God's mercy never fail. As we hear testimony after testimony, right? God is good.
I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In the darkest night, you light knows like no other. I know you as a father. I know you as a friend. And I have been in the goodness of God. All my life that you've been faithful. All my life you've been so, so good. Every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Your goodness is running after me.
Your goodness is running, running after me. Your goodness is running, running after me. When I lay down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running, running after me.
Your goodness is running after me.
Your goodness is running, running after me. Your goodness is running, running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now in everything to me. Your goodness is running after me. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. And I will sing of the goodness of God.
Father, we just want to thank you.
Lord, indeed, you are good.
Lord, we enjoy all the goodness that you have bestowed upon our life. Even when we look across the auditorium today, Lord, I thank you for your faithfulness, for all the good work you've done in individuals' life. Lord, we want to give you all the glory. We want to give you all the thanks. We thank you for 252 Agora. Lord, I just thank you to give us the wisdom and the ability to come forth and say that, Lord, we just want to serve you. We serve you because, Lord, you have been so faithful to us. And, Lord, today we committed ourselves to you and say that we want to be faithful to you. Lord, even as we remain faithful to you, we walk this journey with you. We pray that, God, you continue to reveal your purpose in our life. That, Lord, we have a purpose in us that is to show forth your glory to the world. And in so doing, God, you enrich our life. You make us a better person. And even Royston said, we shall be better. And we shall be brave. And we shall carry ourselves even as a church out into the world. And we are so proud and we're so privileged to be the ambassador of Christ. The Lord, I just pray that you make our lifestyle as a reflection of your goodness in our life. And let us bring that favor and flavor even into the marketplace. From your favor that you have bestowed upon us, we'll go forth and be the salt and light. And Lord, we just want to thank you. We thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you for your goodness. Even in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. Done. You're dismissed.